Good morning, everybody. Congratulations for braving the heat. We were convinced that a lot of people would think, oh, this is just too hot, we'll watch it at home. Well done. Was that me? Okay, all is well. We're continuing in Ephesians 1 this week. And we hear Paul's prayer, and part of his prayer is this: I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in his holy people, and his incomparably great power for us who believe. This is the same as the mighty strength he exerted when he raised Christ from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly realms. It's Advent. Today is the first Sunday in Advent. And this is when we're thinking that not only do we already have grace in Jesus, but we're looking forward and expecting and waiting for and watching for Christ's return. So we have that hope and we have the strength. In a moment, we're going to sing Great is Thy Faithfulness, where we sing these words, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. But before we do that, here's a prayer from the prayer book for Advent. Let us pray that we may be ready for Christ's coming. All-powerful God, increase our strength of will for doing good, that Christ may find an eager welcome at his coming and call us to his side in the kingdom of heaven, where he lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. So we'll invite our little band, choir, barbershop quartet, up to lead us in this great old favourite song.
Thank you.
That almost brought tears to my eyes. I fell in love with my wife singing opposite her in the choir in Germany 46 years ago. And that's the first time I've seen her singing out the front again. Well, let's respond to God's great faithfulness by expressing our thanks in this Thanksgiving prayer. Gracious God, we humbly thank you for all your gifts so freely given to us, for life and health and safety, for power to work and leisure to rest, and for all that is beautiful in creation and human life. But above all, we praise you for our Saviour Jesus Christ, for his death and resurrection, for the gift of your Spirit, and for the hope of sharing in your glory. Fill our hearts with all joy and peace in believing, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, Megan's going to come and give us some news about this, that, and the other.
Hello, friends. My name is Megan, if I haven't met you. I always say that, and it still is Megan, even if I have met you. But I have some great things to let you know about that's coming up. The first is, if you would have seen on your way in, there's a bookstall at the back. This bookstall is specifically targeted to provide some resources that might help you with your personal Bible reading. And why would we read the Bible? Well, there's this great section in Psalm 19 that I want to just quickly read to you. It says, "The law of the Lord is perfect, refreshing the soul. The statutes of the Lord are trustworthy, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, giving joy to the heart. The commands of the Lord are radiant, giving light to the eyes. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The decrees of the Lord are firm, and all of them are righteous." So great reasons we can be reading God's word. And sometimes actually what we need is some resources to help us, because sometimes variety can actually just make a big difference. The first one I wanted to commend to you is the Daily Reading Bible. If you've not seen this before, they have about 60 daily readings that contain the Bible passage, a few questions to help you reflect on the Bible passage, as well as some place to take notes and a prayer suggestion. You can see just how tiny it is. It's really good for taking with you anywhere. So these are up the back. I think they're a really great resource. Secondly, if you are thinking of doing a family devotion, this book called Wise Up goes through the Proverbs, some of the Proverbs, and is just designed to do with your kids. And so I've actually resourced these out to Lisa Duman. I asked her to check a lot of them for me to see how they worked in family. She's going to be here at 10 o'clock straight after the service. So if you want to speak more about how the family resources work, she'll be here to talk to you about that. And the last one I just wanted to talk about was the Humble Notebook, because sometimes actually can be really helpful if you, in a sermon, want to write notes. I don't know if you find sometimes your mind wandering, obviously not because of the sermon content, but just because of our own distractions. So writing notes can be helpful. It might be that you want to write prayers down or prayer points. And so sometimes just having a notebook is really helpful. And for me, if you have a pretty notebook, that actually really helps as well. So that's another one. So come to the bookstore after if you want to look at some of those resources. Secondly, I'd be great for you to be thinking about who you might be able to invite to your home to watch the carols service on December the 20th. This could be, I guess we can't do carols as we normally would, and so this could be a great time to be able to invite people to your home, share a meal with them, sing along and just enjoy it. It'll be kid-friendly service as well, and so just be thinking and praying for those people who you might be able to invite. That's on December the 20th. And my last announcement is that there's a Christmas Kids Club coming up. This is on Monday and Tuesday, the 21st and 22nd. It just runs for half a day for those days. Again, if you have children or if you know those who have children who come, who might be free, it is the public the week before Christmas, so school is off, and so you might be able to get your friends interested by saying it's, you know, 3.5 hours of Christmas wrapping time that you can just get by yourself. But there, again, are some flyers up the back at the bookstore if you want to give them out. If you have any other questions about that, then please come and ask me as well. Thanks.
Thanks, Megan. We're going to be reading from God's Word, but before we do that, let's pray this prayer together, which you'll recognise from Ephesians. Heavenly Father, as we hear your word today, give us the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that we may know you better. Enlighten the eyes of our hearts in order that we may know the hope to which you've called us, the riches of your glorious inheritance in your holy people, and your incomparably great power for us who believe. Amen. Well, I'm reading Psalm 36. I have a message from God in my heart concerning the sinfulness of the wicked. There is no fear of God before their eyes. In their own eyes, they flatter themselves too much to detect or hate their sin. The words of their mouths are wicked and deceitful. They fail to act wisely or do good. Even on their beds, they plot evil. They commit themselves to a sinful course and do not reject what is wrong. Your love, Lord, reaches to the heavens, your faithfulness to the skies. Your righteousness is like the highest mountains, your justice like the great deep. You, Lord, preserve both people and animals. How priceless is your unfailing love, O God. People take refuge in the shadow of your wings. They feast on the abundance of your house. You give them drink from your river of delights. For with you is the fountain of life. In your light we see light. Continue your love to those who know you, your righteousness to the upright in heart. May the foot of the proud not come against me, nor the hand of the wicked drive me away. See how the evildoers lie fallen, thrown down, not able to rise. Let's respond to the reading of God's word by stating what we believe in the words of the Apostles' Creed, and I'd invite you to stand for this if you're able. We believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. We believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Well, take a seat, please, and I'll invite Michael to come up and open God's word to us.
Good morning, everyone. It's great to be with everyone this morning. It's great to be here where we've got the blessing of aircon. We're going to begin by reading Ephesians chapter 1, verses 15 to 23. So if you want to pull out your phone, your iPad, your hard copy of your Bible. All right, this is Ephesians chapter 1, verse 15. For this reason, ever since I heard about your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all God's people, I have not stopped giving thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers. I keep asking that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that you may know him better. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in his holy people, and his incomparably great power for us who believe. That power is the same as the mighty strength he exerted when he raised Christ from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly realms, far above all rule and authority, power and dominion, and every name that is invoked, not only in the present age, but also in the one to come. And God placed all things under his feet and appointed him to be head over everything for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills everything in every way. This is the word of the Lord. Well, this is our last sermon in the section of Ephesians that we're looking at the moment. We've been looking at Ephesians for the last 5 weeks or so, and we did 14 verses over 5 weeks, and now we're going to sprint through the last 9 verses in 1 week. Now, there's a lot of things that I know. I'm not sure whether this is going to work. Okay. There's a lot of things that I know that I know. I know that 2 plus 2 equals 4. I know that my wife Rachel makes the best brownies that I've ever tasted. And I know that Die Hard isn't a Christmas movie. Some people seem to think that it is, but it definitely isn't. There's also a lot of things that I know that I don't know. I don't know how a microwave works. I don't know how it heats up the food, put it in, put it on for some time, and it comes out warm. I'm not sure how that happens. I don't know what the circumference of the world is, and I'm not sure why some people like TV shows like The Bachelor. But there's an even larger amount of things that I don't know that I don't know. And obviously I can't give you examples of those because I don't know what they are. Knowledge is really powerful. The fact that the coronavirus has had such a devastating effect across the world is because we don't know much about it. When we know more about it, we'll be able to fight it better. Knowledge is powerful, and it's also important because it drives our actions. When we know something, it should change how we live. Now, I walk to church most days. I live in Lane Cove North, and I walk over here, and when I get to Epping Road to cross over, I wait at the side of the road until that little green man appears. And then I walk over Epping Road because I know that getting hit by a car would have a very bad effect on my life. I know the danger that it poses, and I change how I act because of it. I don't just walk straight across Epping Road. But there's also things that are true that don't really change my behaviour. I know that I should still be wearing a mask when I'm in big groups of people, so the chances of me getting COVID or me giving COVID to other people are reduced. But in the last couple of months, I've kind of waned off in doing that. Wrongfully so, I think. And I think wrongfully, it shows that I don't really see COVID as a threat anymore. I'm like, oh, it's not in Australia, it's not that big of a deal. When we know something but we don't let it change our actions, it shows that we don't really believe that it's true, or we don't really care that it's true. And in today's passage, Paul shows us our need to know God, and not just know stuff about God, but that we should know him personally, and that that knowledge should change how we act. Now, today's passage builds off the back of the first 14 verses that we've been looking at over the last couple of weeks, and the first 14 verses lays down this really deep, strong theology. There's so many key points of Christian doctrine that are in these 14 verses, things like we've been blessed with every spiritual blessing, God chose us before the foundation of the world, we're called to be holy and blameless, God predestined us to be his sons and daughters, we have redemption through Jesus' blood, which is found in forgiveness, and that forgiveness comes because of grace, not because of anything that we've done. God has made known to us the mystery of his will. God will unite everything under Jesus. We share in God's inheritance. We've been given the Holy Spirit, and all of this has been done to bring glory to God. That's a lot to find in 14 verses. So after this, Paul goes on to pray to God that he would make these things known to the Ephesians, that they'll know them, but not only know them, that they'll believe them and act on them. It's not just knowledge for their brains, It's knowledge for their heart that shapes how they live. I'm going to pray before we get into our passage, so please pray with me as we ask God to illuminate our minds as he illuminated the minds of the Ephesians. Dear Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you that in it you reveal the mystery of your will to us. Please illuminate our minds and open our hearts to hear what you have to say. And please help us to be so convicted of its truth that it drives how we choose to live our lives. Amen. Well, these verses, 15 to 23, make up a prayer that Paul prays to God for the Ephesians. And what is it that Paul prays for? Well, he prays, if we look at verse 17, he prays that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you the spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of him, having the eyes of your minds enlightened, that you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power towards us who believe. So Paul prays that God will give the Ephesians the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of God so that they can know three things. The first thing is the hope to which God has called them. The second thing is the riches of God's glorious inheritance. And the third thing is the immeasurable greatness of God's power. But this isn't knowledge for knowledge's sake. Paul gives praise for this knowledge for a reason. Now, when I was at uni, which was a while ago now, my friends and I really liked trivia nights, primarily for the free food, but we enjoyed the trivia as well. And there was a phase at uni where I was going to a trivia night 4 nights a week. And we did pretty well in these trivia nights, mainly because we had a lot of practice. But we also had a lot of our bases covered. We had someone who was good with geography, we had someone who was good with music, we had someone who was good with movies, and we had someone who was good with sport. But we didn't really learn this knowledge for any real reason. It was kind of just random knowledge that sat in the back of our minds that posed no use to us until a trivia question got asked about it. It didn't change the way we live. It didn't impact decisions that we made in our lives. And that's not the kind of knowledge that Paul is talking about here. Paul is talking about knowledge that changes how we live. Now, look at the phrase that he uses in verse 18. It says, having the eyes of your hearts enlightened. Now, our brains are where we know things. All the logical stuff happens in our brains, but our hearts are what drives our desires, our passions, and to a large extent, our decision-making. It's relatively easy to convince someone of something logically, but it's not as easy to convince someone to change how they feel about something. Now, I hope not to offend anyone here, but you can tell me all you want about classical music. You can tell me how great it is. You can tell me about all of the intricacies of the melody that's happening, the difficulty of a symphony playing together to produce this beautifully crafted piece of music. I can know all that, but it's probably not going to change my heart about classical music. I just don't get it. I don't understand it. I'm not going to decide when I get in the car to turn on Classic FM. But if I understand these things in my heart, I'll be putting Beethoven's Fifth Symphony on repeat. I'll be listening with deep intent to pick up all of the beautiful intricacies. I'll be getting a yearly pass to the Sydney Symphony Orchestra, and I'll be spending my time reading and listening and studying all about classical music. And that's what Paul prays for the Ephesians, that they will know the truth of God's mystery, that it will open the eyes of their hearts, and they will see the hope that they have in Christ. They'll know the inheritance that they have, and that they'll understand God's power. Just like Paul prays for the Ephesians, we should be praying that God will give us a spirit of wisdom and revelation so we can understand those things as well. The hope that we have, the inheritance that we have, and the power that God has. And these three things come out at the end of verse 18 and in verse 19, and we're going to look at them in turn. Now, hope is a very important thing. When we were in lockdown a couple of months ago, one of the things that kind of kept me going through having to stay in our houses for a long time was the hope that one day in a few weeks we'd be able to get back outside. And you hear about people who have been in terrible life situations, whether they're trapped in rubble after a building's collapsed, or maybe they're lost in the wilderness, or maybe they've been put in jail for something that they haven't actually done. And they'll say that the things that kept them going through these hard times is hope. Our former US President Franklin Roosevelt said, "We have always held to the hope, the belief, the conviction that there is a better life, a better world beyond the horizon." Now, obviously, he was talking about America and the hope that America would have a better future after he was there. But I think as Christians, we can kind of co-opt this as our own. God has promised us a better life beyond the horizon of this life. We could say Christians always hold to the hope, the belief, the conviction that there is a better life, a better world beyond the horizon of this life. Look at verse 18 again. It says, "That you may know what is the hope to which he has called you." Paul prays that the Ephesians will know the hope to which God has called them. Now, in the New Testament, they use the word hope differently to how we might use it now. We might say that we hope we get the job that we've gone for, or we hope that we're going to have spaghetti bowl for dinner tonight. But the New Testament uses it the way that we might use the term, "Oh, we're looking forward to." "Oh, we're looking forward to Christmas. We know it's coming. It just hasn't happened yet." And as Christians, we have so much to hope for. We have the hope of salvation. We have the hope of being made righteous. We have the hope of resurrection in an incorruptible body. We have the hope of eternal life, the hope of God's glory, as well as a whole bunch of other things to hope for. And because we have this great hope, this true and definite reality to look forward to, it changes how we live now. When we know and understand the hope to which God has called us, it makes living our lives now a whole bunch easier. If we know the riches of God's kingdom, we won't feel like we have to buy all of the experiences and things we can before we die, because we know that even if we live the most opulent life we can now, it'll be nothing compared to what we hope for after this life. Now, when I was at a previous church, there was a lady who lived there who lived in view of the hope that she had. She was pretty wealthy, and she could have just kicked back and put her feet up enjoyed all of the great things that wealth brings. But in view of the hope that she had for the future, she spent her time and her money serving the church and trying to build up God's kingdom. She catered church events. She had people around for meals almost every week. She volunteered her time each week to put together the church services and to organize church events. She knows what the future holds, and she knows the importance of other people knowing that truth as well. And that knowledge changes how she lives. But living like this won't make life easy. But because we have this great hope to look forward to, it helps us through these hard times. We know something great is coming, which makes the hard life now easier. It's like that last week that you're at work before you go on holidays. Doesn't really matter what comes up in that week. It's so much easier to get through because you know in just a few days you're going to be kicking back on a beach somewhere. And when we truly understand the hope that we have as Christians, it affects how we live now. And one of the hopes that we have is God's inheritance. And that's the next thing that we look at. And the important thing about this inheritance is that it's not our inheritance. It's God's inheritance. Now look at verse 18. It says, "That you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power towards us who believe." Now, we do have an inheritance. Paul's talked about that in verse 14. But here, it's talking about God's inheritance. And God's inheritance is the saints. We are God's inheritance. Now, you might think that that's a pretty rubbish inheritance. If you got that in a will, you might be quite disappointed. But look how this inheritance is described. It's a glorious inheritance. We are God's inheritance. And when God unites all of his people under Christ, it'll be a glorious thing. God will glory in you. God will glory in us. And when people see God's church united under Christ, that will bring God glory. Paul wants us to know and to understand how much God values us. But he doesn't value us because of anything that we've done. He values us because when he looks at us, he sees his own son. Now, knowing that we're loved can be one of the most comforting and grounding things in this life. If we have someone who loves us unconditionally, that means that we can go through life unafraid or relatively unafraid of making mistakes. We know that even if we mess up, that's not going to change how this person feels about us. And we're going to make so many mistakes in this life. But God isn't sitting up in heaven with some check boxes, keeping track of all of the mistakes that we've made. No matter how many mistakes we make, when God looks at us, he sees his perfect son. And this is so comforting and grounding for us as Christians, because we know that it doesn't matter how many times we mess up. It doesn't change how God feels about us. He still loves us, no matter what. And the third and final thing that Paul wants us to be able to understand in verse 19 is the immeasurable greatness of God's power. Now, as Christians, we need a proper understanding of how powerful God is. God isn't just really powerful. He's not just as powerful as, say, the US president or Jeff Bezos, who's the richest person in the world at the moment. The problem with God's power being incomparable is you can't compare it to anything. Anything you try and compare it to is just going to pale into insignificance. But look at verse 19 to 23. God has power to raise Jesus from the dead. God has the power to sit Jesus at his right hand. God gave Jesus rule and authority over everyone. Over every country, every empire that has ever been and will ever be. And God has placed everything under Jesus' feet. All of these countries, these empires, these kingdoms, they're not just inferior to Jesus, but they're subject to Jesus. There is nothing that God can't do. So when we're praying to God, we need to keep in mind just how powerful God is. And we should know that there's nothing that we can pray that God can't do. Now, that doesn't mean that God will do everything that we ask, but we should pray expectantly, knowing that God can fulfill any prayer that we pray. And that great power, that same power that raised Jesus from the dead, is the power that we have us as we strive to live and work for God in this world. When God says that in the future he will unite everything under Jesus, we can trust that he will do that, and he can do that because he has that power. And God has the power to grow his church. He has the power to bring people to know him, to add people to his inheritance. And because he has that power, we can be confident when we meet here at church, when we invite people along, that it doesn't matter how unlikely it is that someone will become a Christian, God can definitely make that happen. When we understand how powerful God is, it'll change how we live our lives now. Now, knowing stuff is really important. It's really good to read deeply and try and understand everything we can about the Bible, how the whole Bible fits together, what predestination is, who the Holy Spirit is, things like that. But Knowing stuff doesn't save us. Knowing stuff doesn't change how we live. All the doctrine in the world isn't going to change a thing. We need to let that knowledge shape how we live and think and feel. We aren't going to grow in our knowledge and understanding and love of God if we don't let those things that we know change us. There's a verse in James chapter 2, which says, "You believe there is one God, good. Even the demons believe that." Believing in God is good and necessary, but that's not all we need. If that's all we have, then there's nothing to separate us, even from the demons. As well as opening the eyes of our head, we need to pray that God will open the eyes of our hearts so that we can truly understand the hope that we have, that we are God's glorious inheritance, and that so we can understand his incomparable power. And we need to pray for that. So let's pray now as we finish up. Dear Lord, we thank you for revealing to us the mystery of your will. We pray that you'll open the eyes of our hearts to understand, know, and experience the truth of who you are, who we are, and all that you've done for us. Amen.
My friends, I'm going to continue in prayer, and hopefully there'll be a confession to join in. We'll start with. Yeah, great. So we're going to start with confession. We'll conclude with the Lord's Prayer at the end. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we praise you for adopting us as your children and making us heirs of eternal life. In your mercy, you have washed us from our sins and made us clean in your sight. Yet we still fail to love you and serve you as we should. Forgive us our sins and renew us by your grace, that we may continue to grow as members of Christ, in whom alone is our salvation. Amen. O God, our merciful Father, you do not despise the contrite heart, and you have sent Christ Jesus into the world to save sinners, for he is our atoning sacrifice. Assist now our prayers and graciously hear us through Jesus Christ our Lord. Our Heavenly Father, High King of Kings and Lord of Lords, we pray that you will look with favour upon the rulers of this land, for our Prime Minister, Scott Morrison, and our Premier, Gladys Berejiklian, and for all those who hold public office. Incline their hearts to govern wisely and with justice. We pray that you will grant them true spiritual repentance and faith in Christ. Bestow wisdom on their decision-making, to know what is both right and best, and to choose to do the same. Almighty and everlasting God, you alone work great and marvelous things. In your mercy, grant that all those in ministry may proclaim your life-giving gospel and live in accordance with Christ's teachings, that their life may be holy and blameless before you. We commit to your good care and providence, Lord, all those who have gone out for the glory of your name, particularly remembering at this time those serving in missions where they may be unable to travel, unable to access necessities, and hampered and prevented from doing their regular ministry. Grant grace, Lord, to your people here. May we receive your word humbly, and may our hearts be rightly ordered. May we serve you in holiness and righteousness to the glory of your name, for the sake of your gospel among the nations. Lord God, we give thanks that in this nation you have spared so many from COVID-19. We pray that our lives may continue to be a living sacrifice to you, praising and magnifying your mercies to us day by day. We give thanks for the work of healthcare workers and many others, and pray for those too involved in vaccine research. We pray and mourn, Lord, with the many in our world who are suffering and have lost loved ones. Hear our plea for your mercy, Lord. Please join with me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Well, we're going to be meditating on this song that the group will bring to us and praising God for the great things that he's done in Christ Jesus to the praise of his glory. So let's enjoy this as we close our service, and then we'll pray a prayer together after they've sung. How nice is that? I suppose if you're my age, those are the songs that really ring a bell and get you going. Let's pray this prayer together as we close, and be thinking about going forth this week, having that knowledge of the hope we have of God's inheritance in the saints and his power at work within us. Be expecting that. Let's pray. Loving Father, through faith in your Son and his saving death, our sins are forgiven and we share in the life of his body. With gratitude for all your mercies, we offer ourselves to you as a living sacrifice. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Well, bookstall at the back, and plenty of coffee and tea across the road where you can mingle there. We'll wish you a good week. And look.